So, as Alex said, I will be presenting a STEAM paper, but as always in this kind of presentation, it's also my kind of reading of STEAM presentation, so it's a kind of joint production, even if he's not here to check my version of this joint production. So looking at the Russian military involvement in the region. So first point, Russia and Central Asia share more or less the same threat assessment of what is going on in Afghanistan. We discussed that during the panel this morning. The country will probably go to civil war. The Afghan army will be unable to perform. There is a domino theory of spillover. Both Russia and Central Asia also share the same kind of paradoxical criticism, NATO failing Afghanistan, but at the same time, we don't want NATO to leave. So stay, even if you fail. That's a kind of, here also, joint assessment of both Russian and Central Asians, and also the same kind of assessment, and we also discussed that this morning, about the IS insurgency and the risks that it could have for the region. So at the same time, they share a lot, but on the at the Central Asian level, we still see the same inability to adopt a unified regional position. So in a sense, it's the threat assessment is more and more kind of insisting on the dangers, but at the same time, it's business as usual in terms of not trying to create a Central Asian regional cooperation toward Afghanistan. So we always have this issue, or is that more rhetorical than substantive? This kind of discussion that are very current about when we discuss Central Asia actions. If we look at the Russian strategy, so first at the kind of big regional level, we see probably more Russian military involvement in Afghanistan, especially with the fact that Russia is currently drafting an agreement for supplies of weapons for Kabul. We have seen a new arrangement with India, so India will be able to buy Russian weapons for the Afghan army, so a kind of traditional world combination of own partnership of Russia and India on Afghanistan. But we have also seen a rapprochement with Pakistan and probably the Russian support for Pakistan to entry SCO next year, which would be a change in the Russian strategy. And of course, this kind of Russian permanent ambiguities toward China, especially because the Russia-China relationship seen from Moscow is very much a mirror game from the Russia-NATO relationship. So the more the relationship between Russia and NATO deteriorates, the more China is brought as the kind of key partner of Russia, with probably, at least at the narrative level, an enhanced security cooperation, possibly in Central Asia. You know that during years, Russia policy was really to keep China military outside of Central Asia. Steve Blank is in paper, seems to think that there is probably a revision of the Russian policy towards the Chinese military involvement in Central Asia. I would be more cautious and think that it's just the Russian narrative, and I don't feel Russia really interested in having Chinese military more present in the region just because of the bad relationship with NATO. So kind of difficult way of assessing this global Russia-China relationship in Central Asia. And then at the CSTO level, so what we have been seeing very clearly since last year at least is that so Russia is really trying to give preferences to CSTO in discussing security partnership with the Central Asian state, which are member of the CSTO. So clear preference given to multilateral solution and an orientation to bilateral solution only for countries who are not part of the CSTO, so Uzbekistan and Turkmenistan. Last month in December, the CSTO had a meeting, and the official document that was published at the end said that the CSTO needs to be prepared to take preventive actions in Central Asia, so a narrative that we can see as like Russia trying to perform more on the security side in Central Asia, and Kabulov, we discussed him this morning, mentioned also in this related to this December discussion, mentioned both Russia being more present at the Tajik-Afghan border, and as I said, this being more present at the Kazakh border on the Caspian side. So clearly the CSTO is trying to become more involved. If we look at the different elements of this CSTO involvement in the region, of course we always have this question that CSTO has never been tested in action on the ground in Central Asia, and therefore we can always say that, well, maybe the day they will have to perform, they will fail. Well, we don't know for the moment. What is clear is that Russia is trying to push the rapid intervention forces. Technically, they are able, at least on the paper, to intervene in 3 days, which is a very kind of quite fast approach. There have been last summer huge exercises that have been organized in Russia with 65,000 troops that were clearly for the Kyrgyz and Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan Russian-based Russian troops to train in a rapid intervention in the region, with of course this kind of difficult assessment that in case of inter-ethnic tension as in 2010 in Osh, not sure that the CSTO will have the political will to intervene, and in case of interstate tension related to border or water issue, also would be very difficult for Russia or for the CSTO to intervene. Imagine something between Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, where they are both members of CSTO, so technically very difficult for the organization to intervene. If something happened between Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, or Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, also very difficult to imagine Russia would be really ready to intervene and go against Uzbekistan. So these rapid intervention forces are probably more and more well trained, but it would be difficult politically to see how they will be able to intervene. Second important aspect of this CSTO reinforcement is the creation of unified air defense system, which is something that Russia is really pushing for. So it's already signed with Kazakhstan and Belarus, and it's in the process of being discussed with Armenia, Kyrgyzstan, and Tajikistan. And that's an interesting case where it's a multilateral discussion, but which is organized bilaterally. So it's Russia, which is of this country, signing an agreement. And each of these unified air defense systems will be done between one country and Russia, everything under Russia umbrella. So it's less multilateral than it seems to be. And of course, that can always open discussion about what if suddenly Russia is the aggressor. But that's something that the Central Asian member state will not discuss, of course, openly, even if we can imagine that it's part of the internal discussion. What is interesting also to see that there are kind of reinforcements of everything related to aviation in the CSTO. So Russia is sending more attack fighter planes to its two Central Asian military bases. They also try to have more and more drones to be sent in the region, probably also in competition with the US, which is also sending more and more drones. So you have a kind of organization of Central Asia. Russia has been publishing a very comprehensive strategy for what they call no contact war, so everything related to drone. And Team Sukhoi, the Russian firms, is trying to build a strike drone, but of course there are kind of technological challenges for Russia. So kind of long-term looking Russian strategy in trying to make the CSTO more efficient. One of the big issues is, of course, Uzbekistan absence for the CSTO. In a sense, it's better to have it outside when you need to get unanimity and when you want to be sure everybody will be sitting on the Russian side. So in a sense, that makes the CSTO more effective. It can weaken its legitimacy, but technically speaking, it makes it more easy to manipulate. And at the same time, I think we should really not forget that Tashkent is very much reluctant to seeing Russia as the multilateral actor, but bilaterally, Tashkent is much more pro-Russian than we would like to see. And the fact that what happened during Putin's trip to Tashkent, this erasement of the Uzbek debt, as Alex, I think, mentioned this morning, it's really probably paved the way to new loans by Tashkent to buy Russian weapons. So the bilateral Russian-Uzbek strategic partnership is really something which is working more than we want to see, because we are used to see Uzbekistan as the reluctant member. Another point is that Russia remains a major supplier of hard security. We also discussed that a little bit during the previous two panels. As I said, CSTO member states can access Russian weapons, everything from ammunition to aviation at the Russian domestic price. And of course, on that, NATO countries really failed at penetrating market, is the name of this interoperationality with Russia. Last point I wanted to mention, and we also briefly discussed it this morning, is the role of Russia in forming human capital for the military sector in Central Asia. The majority of the military academies in Central Asia are still following the Russian models very much. They are following Russian techniques, Russian textbooks, and so on. The number of Central Asian young soldiers and officers sent to Russia is just huge, depending on the way we can get number. It's from 50 to 80% of all the military personnel trained from Central Asia trained abroad is trained in Russia, which led for NATO country and China a relatively small part. The CIS anti-terrorist center is relatively active. The Council of Border Guard Agency also, and the FSB Center of Special Affectation are the three key Russian institutions that train the military and also that maintain this intelligence exchange and form training for intelligence sector. For the Central Asian intelligence services. So on all these issues, I mean, the Russia is really in a kind of dominant position that is almost impossible to challenge given the current situation. So briefly to conclude, several elements. The first one that Alex mentioned is during the this morning discussion, Russia is clearly operationalizing its strategic domination and military presence in Central Asia, and the CSTO is really the key element of that. Second element, we have no information about the possible lack of confidence that the Central Asian state member of the CSTO could have toward Russia following the Ukrainian crisis, and of course Kazakhstan is for that the key country. No information will come from Kazakhstan probably on that issue because it's very sensitive, but it's sure that at the same time as Kazakhstan will continue to push for having a CSTO, a more and more integrative CSTO, at the same time they should have some discussion about what happens if one day Russia is no more a friendly country. Third conclusion, CSTO, even if it's improving, has no real tool to intervene on what are the more probable issues for Central Asia, inter-ethnic tensions, and interstate tensions in the Fergana Valley. So maybe you could have peacekeeping operation in that case. I mean, trying to send his soldier as peacekeeper, they did at the beginning of the Tajik civil war. But clearly, the rapid intervention forces are technically done for kind of coup d'état or terrorist attack. But then that's not the first risk for the Central Asian region. And for what is really the main risk, probably the CSTO wouldn't have the right tool and the political will to intervene. Fourth conclusion, very briefly, in case of economic backlash for Russia, what would be the price to pay for the Russian army? So probably a Russian army would be the last to be suffering. Clearly, the Putin regime will continue to put huge budget into the army, but that's also bringing back to the discussion that Sebastian initiated about the industrial military complex, the commercial viability of the army, something very important for Russia. It's not only a military issue, it's a commercial issue. They need to sell things, they need to produce, they need to have state investment in this kind of military industrial military structure, and therefore their ability to control Central Asia, not only at the security level, but just at the market for their own production is very important. And last conclusion, kind of more long-term things, is that the Russian army will change GP in the decades to come, and that's something that probably the Central Asian and the Russian decision-making circle will begin to think about. You know, that demographic situation in Russia, and especially drafting of young people, is just decreasing at a very high level, and Russia just decided to redraft North Caucasians. You may know that during years, North Caucasians were not drafted. They are now because Russia needs more people, young men, to be drafted. So that's a kind of long-term structural element. And the more anecdotal, but maybe it's not so much, you may have heard Kadyrov's speeches about being able to send kind of North Caucasian battalion wherever Russia would need them, or discussion about creating a kind of Central Asian foreign legion, so Russian foreign legion for Central Asia. All these elements about that are for the moment anecdotal, but that on the long term, the Muslimization of the Russian army is something that will be create on the long term a kind of reassessment of what Russia could technically do on the ground in Central Asia. Now you stop.